Have you ever felt like many things in your life can be explained by one simple choice that you made? If so, you're right. There's science behind it. Now, ever since I was little, most of my decisions involved as much pragmatics and long thinking as I could afford. I was a typical girl in the back of your science class, raising her hand to answer every question and asking if there would be a homework assignment right after the bell rang. Now, I promise I wasn't a total weirdo, or at least that's what people around me told me. But it doesn't take too much calculations to understand that I wasn't too similar to my classmates. I preferred spending my Friday nights watching YouTube videos on the math concepts that I was not familiar with. So during one of these Friday night browsing sessions, I stumbled upon a video explaining the concept of chaos theory. Initially, I was beyond skeptical of the topic and the contents. I mean, in the science of math, there's never a lack of new theorems and theories, but I never expected to encounter a theorem about chaos. And that is when I knew that math had gone a little too far. But about 60 years ago, a meteorologist at MIT was trying to predict the weather by running simulations on his computer. So the meteorologist, Edward Lorenz, probably hated his boring job and wanted to go back as soon as possible. So when he was supposed to rerun the simulations for the second time, just to take a gander at the first results and make sure that they comply, he actually ended up inputting shorter input numbers, hoping to make his own life easier. However, his results were dramatically different from the initial results, and that is when his job quickly turned from boring into beyond confusing. He looked back at the two simulations and realized that the only thing he did differently was inputting the shorter numbers. So this mishap later caused what we now know as chaos theory. The underlying principle of it is that if something is extremely sensitive to subtle changes, its future trajectory can be very hard to determine, even with the strongest computers at MIT. Then the name of the theory, chaos, also starts making sense because in math, we refer to chaos as systems and events that are not easily predictable. In fact, the ones that are not predictable. And quite frankly, our life is just one big chaos. Like, think of it. It is a system in which the present can determine the future, but the approximate present cannot determine the approximate future. Just like in the definition of the Lorenz's theory. Now, my 13-year-old mind was blown away by this concept. I finally felt like my passion for math was something more than just solutions of problems on a piece of paper. The old and dusty books that hold theorems actually apply to my real life, right? So you can imagine how much my passion grew when I learned about the underlying principle of the chaos theory, known as butterfly effect. Now, the butterfly effect refers to the phenomenon that if a butterfly flaps its wings in Brazil, it can cause a tornado in Texas. Crazy, no? But by coining this term, Lorenz had a simple idea in mind that he was trying to communicate. That is, that the world is deeply interconnected in a way that one simple action can influence systems much greater than that. And looking back into it, had YouTube autoplay not suggested me a video about this topic 9 years ago, I might have not carried on with my passion for math. I might have not studied it in college and might have not been here in front of you today. But it is not only my life that the chaos theory is so directly applicable to. Let me show you examples of how small actions in the past are influencing our future today. Take, for instance, Florence Nightingale. Florence was born in the early 19th century in Italy, and as a young woman, she carried on to become a nurse in Britain, although nursing was not a well-respected profession, especially from a woman who comes from a very high social stance like her. However, her success in the field led to the British government entrusting her with taking care of the soldiers during the Crimean War. So Florence led a team of nurses in Scutari, the Ottoman Empire, and she was horrified by the condition that the victims of war were living in. She then dedicated all of her efforts to advocating for the dignity and well-being of the soldiers by demanding clean water and food supply, clean bandages, bed sheets, and so on. Nightingale even went out of her way and started writing letters to the families of the soldiers. Years later, her efforts in Crimea earned her recognition not only in London, but all around Europe and the world. Now let's fast forward exactly 200 years from Nightingale's birth. It is 2020, and there is another war in the region, not too far from the Scutari Hospital where Nightingale was working at. This time, it is in my homeland, Armenia. And many of the wounded soldiers are my childhood friends or my classmates. They're being treated by the Red Cross volunteers. But what you might not know is that years after Nightingale's death, a wealthy man, Henry Dunant, found the letters that she wrote to the families of the soldiers, and they inspired him to establish what we now know as the International Red Cross. Nightingale's beliefs still lie at the fundamentals of the Red Cross and serve as a cause for saving thousands of lives around the world. So just by a small action of writing letters to these families, she reformed our entire understanding of the nursing profession and caused the establishment of one of the largest humanitarian organizations of our days. So Nightingale came from a high social stance, and she also had a job that was dealing with families all the time. So to some, it might seem intuitive that she had the handles to change the world. But let me tell you an opposite story. Take, for example, François Pienaar. Pienaar was born into an Afrikaner family, and growing up, he had immense passion for rugby. So his passion led him to playing at the provisional level, and then he later became the captain of the national rugby team during the 1995 Rugby World Cup Championship. At a time, the country's democratically elected president was Nelson Mandela, and he was working tirelessly to reunite post-apartheid South Africa. Pienaar ended up actually winning the finals against New Zealand and earning South Africa the 1995 Rugby World Cup. Nowadays, 30 years later from the actual happenings, South Africa has left the apartheid mentality far behind. But for many, it was not Mandela's leadership that caused this social change. Rather, it was a simple photo that you're seeing on the screen, where Mandela came out on the field of rugby in front of 63,000 viewers, 62 out of which were Afrikaners, and only 1,000 were Africans. By a simple gesture of shaking a hand of the black president, Pienaar reformed the Afrikaner understanding of the black community. So again, by a seemingly small act, he stirred passion from his fellow teammates, Mandela himself, and changed the mentality of an entire nation. And the historical examples of the chaos theory are far too many. Many things that we come across in life can be traced back to their own butterfly effects, related to people that we always talk about, or maybe people that we have never heard of. But things like globalization, travels, and internal collaboration have made the world seem much bigger than it used to be. So reforming a profession, or changing lives, changing a nation's mentality, might seem much harder than it was in the past. So in other words, our pond might have gotten much bigger, and we might feel smaller. But that does not mean that we cannot stir big waves today. Now, when I was 15, my biggest concern in life was passing my freshman year chemistry class because I swear my teacher hated me just as much as I hated her subject. So when I finally passed that last exam, you can imagine how ecstatic I was to have received an offer to volunteer at the Armenian countryside at an international film festival. So I was working to interpret the events from Armenian to English for international guests. And during this 1 week at a charming village, I met people from all different backgrounds and all different stories. The one that stood out to me the most was a 9-year-old named Armen. Armen was born and grew up in the village itself, and he had undeniable passion for football. That is what you guys call soccer. So when I was trying to seem cool and befriend this 9-year-old, I tried to start a conversation about the World Cup championships that were taking place during those weeks. Armen was very quick to remind me that they own neither a TV nor internet connection for him to follow the games. I tried to stir the conversation in a different direction and offered to play football with him right on the spot. He then let out a soft giggle and told me that he does not own a football. So there was an awkward silence in the room, and in my last attempt, I offered to buy him a football from the only store in the village, right there. However, he let out a laughter that I have never heard of sorts before, and he told me that their only store in the village sells only alcohol and spices. And for there to be a football on those shelves, it would be nothing short of a miracle. Now, although this conversation was years ago, it grounded me in a way that I did not expect to be grounded. Armin's little story served as a catalyst for my passion to helping children from vulnerable communities at any chance I have gotten. He prompted me to volunteer with various European governments and hold lessons with students from all around the world. I even went so far as to co-found my own social enterprise, helping children from vulnerable communities in a way that matters. I'm gonna be honest with you, that small conversation stirred in me passion and then quickly turned into a social impact that I would not have dared to even dream of. But let's take a step back. What does this mean? This means that we are all pretty similar. We all have a potential to take a small action that could later turn into something purposeful. Maybe something that we always wanted to see come to life, something that we have always dreamt of. I know for me, somewhere after that short YouTube video, I started believing in the power of my small actions, and now I'm standing in front of you here today, 11,000 kilometers away from what I call home. That is 120,000 football fields for everybody who hates the metric system. But it turns out that the only way we can stand out in this ginormous world as microscopic creatures is not by liking math or being a boring meteorologist or by becoming a nurse or playing a professional sport. I'm convinced that the only way we can stand out is by taking small actions that we believe in the potential of and watching the world turn it into something much greater than us. So, have you ever felt like our future can be determined by one small action of yours? Now you know the science behind it. Thank you.